Modern day battery chemists are forever looking for ways to squeeze more juice out of the cells that power our modern day lives, while maximizing the number of charging cycles they can endure and minimizing the time it takes to charge them. It's a very difficult balance to strike, a bit like whack-a-mole, fix one problem and another one pops up somewhere else. Very frustrating. One tantalizingly elusive holy grail is to find a way to use pure lithium metal instead of graphite as the storage medium for liberated lithium ions over on the anode side of the cell. Pure lithium metal offers much higher energy density than graphite or silicon-based materials, but it has the annoying tendency to grow dendrites that can cause short circuits, and it can react quite unhelpfully with existing electrolyte solutions, potentially causing cell swelling and rapid failure. Lots of people much smarter than me have been trying to address the multifarious challenges with solid lithium anodes in laboratories all over the world in recent years, some of whom we've covered in videos on this channel. Now, a bunch of bright sparks at the Korean Advanced Institute of Science and Technology, or KAIST, have put their collective heads above the parapet and declared a game-changing breakthrough that they claim can extend the life of a lithium metal anode by 750%. Quite specific, isn't it? So let's see what they've come up with, shall we? Hello, and welcome to Just Ever Think. Now, if you're someone who's watched some or all of the many videos on battery chemistry that we've produced over the years here on the channel, then you might want to skip forward a couple of minutes at this point. For everyone else, here's a useful recap of how a typical lithium-ion battery works. A lithium-ion battery is a rechargeable electrochemical cell that stores and releases energy through the movement of lithium ions between a cathode and an anode across a liquid electrolyte containing a separator that's there to prevent short circuits. Modern cathodes are generally composed of some sort of lithium metal oxide, and anodes are typically made of graphite. As the lithium ions arrive on the anode side during the charging process, they nestle or intercalate within the lattice-like molecular structure of the graphite material. During discharge, the ions are liberated to move back to the cathode, and electrons flow out via a current collector through an external circuit to do some useful work. Graphite's become the go-to workhorse of battery anodes. It's a cheap and abundant material, already commercially mature and widely available. It's got a reasonably good energy density of around 372 milliamp hours per gram, and it has a relatively low electrical potential relative to lithium in the cathode. And as I'm sure you already know, the potential difference or voltage across a cell is a key factor in determining how much bang you get for your buck, so to speak. Silicon anodes do things a bit differently. They store lithium ions by forming an alloy. They've got higher electrical potential of between 0.2 and 0.5 volts relative to lithium, but also a much higher theoretical energy density than graphite at around 3,600 milliamp hours per gram. The trouble with silicon anodes, though, is that the alloying process causes significant expansion during the charging process. That results in mechanical damage that leads to loss of electrical contact and low cycle life. So silicon is rarely used on its own. It's generally combined with graphite in a kind of hybrid anode, like the one used in Tesla's 4680 cells. A pure lithium metal anode allows lithium ions to deposit directly onto the metal surface. In theory, this setup offers the highest energy density at around 3,860 milliamp hours per gram, more than 10 times the density of graphite. And because it's lithium, its electrical potential relative to lithium is obviously zero, which is as low as you can get, and which therefore means maximum potential difference or voltage between cathode and anode. Lithium metal anodes are being enthusiastically pursued for solid state batteries, like the one from QuantumScape that we've been periodically talking about on the channel for about the last 7 years or so, and which one day may actually become a commercial reality. One day. Probably. The frustration with lithium metal, according to the science bots working on them, is that the lithium ions don't arrive in a nice uniform pattern at the anode surface, so they tend to deposit unevenly onto the lithium metal, and that's what causes irregular localized buildups that the battery chemists refer to as dendrites. Over repeated charge cycles, dendrites can pierce through the separator in the electrolyte and reach the cathode on the other side, at which point your battery is kaput and quite possibly on fire, which you don't want. And then there's that reaction with the electrolyte that I mentioned at the start of the video. Lithium metal is highly reactive with common liquid electrolytes, and that can lead to something called an unstable solid electrolyte interface, or SEI. So what's that then? Well, an SEI is a protective layer that forms on the lithium metal surface when the battery is first used. It's like a thin skin that prevents the lithium reacting too much with the electrolyte. If the SEI is unstable, then it tends to keep breaking and reforming, which allows a little bit of lithium to be lost with each cycle. That reduces the battery's capacity over time and increases resistance in the cell, which makes the battery less efficient. As the lithium reacts with the electrolyte, it produces a gaseous byproduct that can cause swelling, and in extreme cases, if the pressure gets too high, the cell can catch fire, which you don't want. And the reaction itself means the electrolyte gets used up over time, leading to dry spots that hamper battery performance. Eventually, over multiple charge and discharge cycles, assuming the cell hasn't spontaneously combusted, it runs out of electrolyte and stops working completely, which is annoying. So, you know, one or two little wrinkles to iron out there. Which brings us to this latest research paper from the Korean Institute. The goal of the research was to produce what the paper's authors describe as a robust artificial solid electrolyte interface layer to overcome the instability of the lithium. But the KAIST researchers also wanted to address another generally overlooked issue, which is the environmental impact of the manufacturing process and materials of existing artificial SEI layers. The two materials selected for testing by the KAIST team were carboxymethyl guar gum and polyacrylamide. Guar gum is a natural water-soluble carbohydrate polymer extracted from the seeds of the guar plant. It's already widely used in food, pharmaceuticals, cosmetics, and some other industrial applications as a thickener, stabilizer, emulsifier, and gelling agent. Polyacrylamide, or PAM, is a material that you will no doubt recognize as a synthetic polymer from the petrochemical industry. In its purest form, this stuff is water-absorbing, non-reactive, and non-toxic, and is commonly used for medical and cosmetic products. Combining these two relatively inexpensive and commercially available products resulted in an artificial SEI membrane that was both chemically and physically reinforced. The membrane was fabricated using what they refer to as an environmentally friendly electrospinning process that created tiny hollow nanofiber channels in the material. Those channels provided mechanical stability by directing lithium ions in such a way as to promote much more uniform lithium plating. So that pretty much did away with the dendrite problem. And the nanofiber protective layer also provided chemical stability by effectively controlling reversible reactions between the electrolyte and lithium ions. That significantly reduced the undesirable gaseous degradation of the liquid electrolyte. The consequence of all that was stable electrochemical plating and stripping reactions that allowed a cell cycle life roughly 7.5 times longer than an unprotected lithium metal anode. So a good start. The researchers tested their new anode with three different cathode compositions and achieved capacity retentions as high as 94% at 1 charge per hour over 300 charge cycles, which they describe as world-class performance. According to this spec chart, the ubiquitous 2170 cell made by Panasonic achieves a capacity retention of 80% after 1,000 cycles, so the KAIST team are certainly in the right ballpark. And at the end of the process, the team claim their SEI material fully decomposes in soil within a month, which they say makes it an eco-friendly design from production to disposal. Professor Il-Doo Kim of the KAIST Department of Materials Science and Engineering said, "As the environmental burden caused by battery production and disposal becomes a pressing issue due to surging battery demand, this water-based manufacturing method with biodegradable properties will significantly contribute to the commercialization of next-generation eco-friendly batteries." Well, we'll see, won't we? We've all witnessed apparently groundbreaking discoveries like this coming out of laboratories all over the world at a rate of about 1 or 2 a week in recent years, haven't we? Most of them will never see full-scale commercial realisation. But a few of them will, and you never know, this might be one of them. We certainly shouldn't delude ourselves that adding a biocompatible component to lithium-ion battery chemistry suddenly makes the whole thing environmentally friendly, though. I don't think anyone's making that claim. But if one more element can be produced in a less harmful way, then that's a step in the right direction, isn't it? And if it's a more eco-friendly material to dispose of, then that'll make the job of the rapidly growing recycling industry that bit easier as well. And that has to be a good thing, doesn't it? So what do you think? Is this one a potential goer or another tantalising glimpse into the art of the possible but not the practical? Maybe you work in the battery industry. If you do, then it'd be great to get a bit of insight from your point of view. Whatever your opinion though, the place to leave your thoughts, as always, is in the comment section below. That's it for this week. Thanks as always to the amazing folks over at Patreon who make this channel possible and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. And I must just give a quick shout out to some folks who've joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Elizabeth, Clint, Dan McNeese, Mark, Thomas Tilk, Stephen Pargeter, Peter Min, and Bob. And of course, a huge thank you to everyone else who's joined since last time too. If you feel like you'd like to get involved with that, then jump over to patreon.com/justhaveathink to find out how you can join the team and have a look at all the exclusive perks you can get there, including introductory free membership and paid membership for as little as $1 a month now. And if you enjoyed this video, then you can really hugely support me by hitting the subscribe button on YouTube and clicking on all notifications. Won't cost you a penny to do that, and it's just a simple click away, either down there somewhere or on that icon there. Most important of all though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.